Police wearing special protective clothing switched their search at this house today, just down the road from the one where the grisly search for human remains has been going on for the last 12 days.
We understand that the police called on the owners of number 163 Melrose Avenue today because they own two dogs, and those two dogs might have picked up some of the bones from 195 Melrose Avenue and buried them in their back garden.
Police described it tonight as only a cursory search and said they will be checking other gardens in the street as well.
Exactly what the significance is of September 1975, the police won't say. But they did allow us in this morning to see for ourselves what they've been doing for 3 days now beneath the blue tarpaulin in the garden of number 195. They've still explored only a quarter of the area, and it'll be the end of the week before they get through their unpleasant task. They remain confident that anything buried lies just below the surface, which is why they're digging only to a spade's depth. Comparatively little has so far been found, perhaps because the search started next to the house, but further fragments were recovered in today's sifting, which the police believe are human remains. It may be that very little of what is recovered will be identified, but the attempt will be made.
Anything that is found is given to one of my exhibit officers, and the item of concern will then go to the laboratory for scientific examination.
Is it very small remains that have been discovered so far?
Minute ones, yes. In the majority of cases.
As today's fragments made their way to the forensic laboratory, it was feared that the garden at number 195 was still retaining most of its secrets. Michael Oliver, ITN, Britain, in North London. The 37-year-old accused was taken to Highgate Magistrates Court in police custody 2 hours before he was due to appear. He'd been charged yesterday evening after questioning during the day. He was dressed in an open-necked shirt and wore spectacles. Reporting restrictions were not lifted.
It was precisely 10 o'clock when Dennis Andrew Nilsen was led into the dock to face the bench of three magistrates. The charge, a single charge, of murdering Stephen Neil Sinclair was read over to him. There were objections to bail and no application was made. And he was remanded in police custody until Wednesday the 16th of February. At just 1 minute past 10, he was taken down to be driven away at some speed in a police van.
The van escaped unscathed from the media's attentions and made its way to Hornsey Police Station, where investigations are continuing. Michael Oliver, ITN, Highgate.
The cadets arrived two by two, almost parade ground style, straight from the police training centre at Hendon. They're 17 years old, mostly boys, though there were some girls. And they set to work straight away on their hands and knees, scrabbling away at the surface soil on the wasteland behind the house and clearing the brush with rods. After an hour, they were so cold their instructor ordered exercises, but they did make some finds.
We are continuing the search of the rear garden, as I've already told you over the past few days. But this morning, we're also, in addition, dealing with the what I call the waste ground at the back of these premises you'll see behind me. Officers from the cadet school have started a careful search of the undergrowth, and I think it's right to say that we have found a significant amount of human bones. Apart from that, we've also found a large quantity of personal clothing, and the difficulties with that, of course, is that there may well be a situation where local people are throwing their rubbish on this common ground, which will add to the complications. Since I last spoke to you, we have found in the rear garden, as opposed to the common ground, various other bones and also a part of a jaw with teeth attached to it.
Is it possible to say whether it's a male or female jaw?
I can't tell you.
And what kind of clothing have you found?
At the present moment, it's just ordinary clothing. We haven't looked at it minutely, but it's ordinary clothing. I can tell you more once I've seen it.
How much information can forensic pathologists glean from the skeleton of a corpse?
Well, it depends largely on how much you've got. Now, if you take small fragments of bone like this, you may not be able to tell whether they're human or not. But sometimes a small bone like this is very informative. This piece of bone is from some cremated but untouched remains which were disposed of in a rather unusual fashion. And we can tell immediately that this is human And not only that, but we know that a post-mortem was carried out on this body before it was cremated. And it was probably female and probably fairly young.
How do you tell the age of a person from remains such as these?
Well, that depends on how old the person is. If they're young, children up to 22, 23, that's a period, you can tell from the ends of the bones. If the bones are night, and the bones are night, and they stop growing, and that this follows a regular progression. After 25, it becomes more difficult, and one uses an articular surface of the pelvis, the bones in the front of the pelvis, pubis, and the articular surface there will give you a reasonable idea of the age. And then, as you get older, so it becomes more difficult, and get very old, we go over 40, we go for the closures of the sutures, first of all on the inside, and all the way through these periods of life, one also goes for the teeth, because there are various ways of estimating age from the wear and tear on the teeth.
Professor Mon's colleague, Dr. Lee, gave me some examples.
Occasionally, a skull or other bone may indicate the injuries which are present. This skull here, we can see that part of the right-hand side is missing. There are some very superficial marks on the bone fragments here that indicate the kind of weapon that had been used. And I was able to suggest that this individual had probably been chopped in first with an axe, which was subsequently shown to be the case. This scapula or shoulder blade shows a couple of injuries as well. These were picked up once a very badly decomposed body was located. And these injuries are bayonet injuries. Very unusual, but we do have the odd homicide committed with bayonets. They're obviously very useful if one can pick them up.
These bones have already yielded their secrets to the forensic pathologist. But whether the remains the police have found in North London will be enough to reveal the terrible secrets of 195 Melrose Avenue remains to be seen.
It is Scotland Yard's Missing Persons Bureau which has the grim task of trying to pull together all the information on the thousands of people who simply disappear every year. At any one time, they have 600 bodies on their hands with simply no clues as to their identity. In most cases, they're homeless drifters who've lost all contact with their relatives. Some are never identified. The West London Day Centre cares for and feeds 3,000 homeless every week. In recent years, there's been a large increase in the number of young people passing through its doors. They've come to London in search of jobs. Instead, they find themselves penniless and living off the streets. It's a twilight world with few friends.
We had a person who died on the streets last year, and it was 3 weeks before his body was found. It was only just around the corner in Marylebone Station.
What can be done to prevent this sort of thing happening?
I don't think there's a great deal that can be done, because most of the people who come down to town, or into London, I mean, they come here, but certainly can be anonymous. And many times they use names that are not their own. I mean, there's people that we deal with who we use the name that they give us, and in many cases we know that they have another name. And so even if they're reported missing, the chance of them being traced are highly unlikely. We had a case some years ago of a man. They didn't know who he was until after he was dead, and they fingerprinted him and found that he'd got a record. Then they found out who he was. Because people just use different names all the time.
Those people who run the hostels and provide what help they can say that because of unemployment, it's a problem that can only get worse. David Chater, News at 10, Central London.
Thank you, Michael, and hello. Dennis Nilsen, the man who once called himself the murderer of the century, tonight starts a life sentence for 6 murders in North London. He once boasted he could have killed 500 people had he not been stopped. The judge at the Old Bailey said he should stay in prison for at least 25 years. Nielsen, a 37-year-old civil servant, showed no emotion as sentence was passed. He denied murdering six young men between 1980 and 1982. He admitted killing them and maybe nine more and cutting up their bodies at houses where he lived in Cricklewood and Muswell Hill. But Nielsen claimed it was manslaughter because of diminished responsibility. Eight or even nine of his victims to this day remain unidentified. Young men with no names, no known addresses, jobless, rootless, and friendless. Some were Scots, some were Irish. Others were described as vagrants, hippies, and skinheads. And as Stephen Chambers now reports, there are many more just like them, alone in London tonight.
No one will give a precise figure on the number of young people sleeping rough in London tonight, except to say the problem's getting worse by the moment, with middle-class southerners now joining the traditional working-class emigres from the north in the hunt for that elusive job.
How long have you been in London?
Just over a week.
Why on earth did you come down here?
There's a sat all in Liverpool. It's simple. There's no work. Even my dad, has been out of work for 9 years. Only just got a job now. Sitting girls in all sorts, electricals, plumbing, anything. You just can't get anything. So what have I got down there? No future at all.
Jimmy's lucky. He's got a bed in the dormitory here at the Centrepoint Hostel in Soho. But with space limited and the demand vast, it can only be temporary. But the staff here will help with social security and other problems before turfing him out again.
Well, yes, I think we might have some space. If you could bring John Abel down to our gate and we'll interview him to let him in.
But however many such voluntary agencies may shelter at night, there's little that can be done to fill their days and their pockets. With lengthening dole queues and barely enough state cash for even the basic necessities like food, many young drifters find other alternatives.
And what about the business of male prostitution, which is fairly rife around here as well?
Well, you see them around. I've got at least two friends who are. But
because they want to
life.
Be?
I'm not too sure. They don't talk about it much. Whether they enjoy it or not is up to them. It's their life.
Well, they make money, presumably, don't they?
Yes.
Good money?
I don't know. They've always got money in their pockets.
And the police, particularly the West End Street Offences Squad, are only too aware that the rootless youngster represents not only a potential criminal, but also a potential victim, as the Nielsen trial all too vividly revealed.
When you get young people on their own in the West End without really much experience of life, they can become involved through the many other sordid characters that we have in the area. They could indeed become victims in a similar fashion.
Despite run-ins with the police, the newcomers like Jimmy and Jason remain confident that with a lucky break, a good deal perhaps, all will work out. The long-standing drifters, though, find the facade of confidence more difficult to maintain.
What are your feelings at the moment, though? I mean, are you frustrated, lonely?
No, not really. No, I'm just hoping that it just changes, but so far it hasn't.
What do you see yourself doing in, say, a year's time?
I'm in a bed sitting and getting a job.
You think that's really likely?
No, not a chance.
And with no hope and no money, the temptations come easy. The prospect of a free drink and meal virtually irresistible, no matter the real motives of the person making the offer. This is Stephen Chambers in the West End.
A sad story behind the Dennis Nilsen case. It was claimed today that private...
We rang the police from the house the next day after the mass had mysteriously disappeared from the manhole.
So on Tuesday night, there was a lot of flesh, a lot of meat in the manhole. When you went back on Wednesday morning, it had all gone?
Yeah, completely. If a manhole can be sparkling, it was sparkling. Somebody had obviously been down there and cleared it out.
Do you think someone had cleared it, or could it have been cleared naturally?
No way. No way. Not that amount of flesh, should we say.
Fine, Mike, if you just come to me and just stand just in front of me as we come. That's fine. Yes.
Okay. Well, how'd you do?
I'll make sure it's no car stuff. Run it.
When were you called to the house?
First instance, Tuesday evening, 6:15.
That was from the estate agents?
Yes, that's correct.
Because of a blocked toilet?
Blocked pipe between the toilet and the main sewer.
It was then that you made the discovery?
After initial investigation, yes. Yeah.
What did you find?
A mass of flesh, shall we say. Which at first...
You know what you'd found?
Heavily suspected. I have a limited knowledge, but very heavily suspected that it wasn't animal, shall we say.
Who did you talk to in the house at the time?
All of the tenants that were there. Two ladies and the two gentlemen.
Did anyone express any particular interest in what you found?
Certainly. most of them were quite interested, shall we say. There was some talk about calling the police, but how often does one find remains of a body down a drain, you know? Chances are it could have been deep freezer meat, any food stuff. Remains, but there just seemed to be too much of it, should we say. There was an awful lot of it.
Was there enough there for more than one body?
Quite possibly. Quite possibly. Yeah.
And what are your feelings now about what has happened?
Horrifying, quite frankly. Just horrifying. I hope it doesn't happen again. You know, I'm not in the habit of this.
Okay, that's fine. When you made the discovery, one of the people in the house was quite interested.
That's correct. Yes, the guy, I believe, was living in the top floor flat. Yeah.
What did he say about it?
He expressed an interest on how the material was going to be removed from the manhole. This conversation was between himself and the other male tenant. And they were discussing methods of removing this stuff. Most of the suggestions came from the other tenant, not the guy in the top floor flat. And I presume, you know, he extracted some kind of information from that. But on reflection, it was an above average interest in...
Can we cut this?
Asleep inside.
Maybe you could just tell me, Jim. The lady can just tell us what... Can you tell us what you saw with the police activity, what the police were doing?
Well, all I saw was a torch going up and down. That's all.
Last night?
Last night, in the dark.
Did you see the police taking anything away?
I didn't. No, my son-in-law lives in the front, upstairs. He saw two plastic bags full of heavy ones. So yeah, I don't know what was in it. But it was put in a van and taken away.
What sort of people were your neighbours? How did you get on with them?
I didn't ever talk to them. They were a terrible lot. They were all kinds of people, you know. Well, I don't know quite how to describe them. They were here today and gone tomorrow. That's about all there is to it.
Pity one.
Oh, you're not doing me, are you?
Is it?
The house isn't in good condition, but it does have vacant possession and a unique history. All the tenants of 23 Cranley Gardens, Muswell Hill, moved out last February, shortly after police arrested Dennis Nilsen, the homosexual civil servant jailed at the beginning of this month for 6 murders and 2 attempted murders, the man who told police he'd killed a total of 16 men and that he felt no pity for his victims. He even boiled parts of them in his kitchen.
When I realised what had been happening next door, I felt ill. It was horrible. I used to smell the cooking. I didn't know what it was. I do now, and I, you know, after the event.
3 of Nielsen's victims were chopped up here in the front room of his top-floor flat. Police removed human limbs from this room. Now they've fumigated and redecorated the whole flat and replaced all the plumbing. The house's owner, an Indian housewife, wants a quick sale. There's no fixed price. The house is open to offers.
It could be that the property won't sell at all, or it could be that it will fetch an astronomical price.
Houses round here normally do sell quite easily, don't they?
Yes, they do. They do. I understand that the value, if it was not affected by the incident, would be in the region of 60,000 to 70,000.
How are you going to sort out people who want to come and look at the house, people who actually might want to buy it, and others who just want to have a look?
Yes, we haven't actually decided how to deal with this problem. We do anticipate getting a number of time wasters, people that just want to sightsee and come along and have a look. I suppose we'll have to have an open day or something just to let people come and have a look.
There have already been 3 offers for 23 Cranley Gardens, and a film company may rent the house to make a film of Dennis Nielsen's grisly and incredible story. Ros Morris in Muswell Hill for Thames News.
What about your parents? I mean, can't they help?
No, no.
Got nobody that you can turn to? Thank you. Here we
go. Sometimes I'm happy, sometimes I really enjoy being here. Sometimes I'm just not too keen on it. But I'm not really unhappy.
Thank you.
I'd earn some money today
as well. What's the last beef I can show you? Thank you.
I think actually we can leave it there because I
camera.
The clinical and business-like atmosphere of these laboratories belies their association with half a century of murder and mayhem. One exhibit, a completely accurate mock-up of the mass murderer Dennis Nilsen's flat in Muswell Hill. Mock-up it may be, but every kitchen implement, every stick of furniture here is the real thing. So are the commonplace artifacts Nilsen used. The firearms section, where ballistic experts study the effects of shotgun blasts, the highly sophisticated equipment they use to examine bullets, and a grim array of the sort of weapons criminals and terrorists are using today. This electron microscope was used to analyze the tiny poisoned pellet, probably fired from a modified umbrella, which killed exiled Bulgarian journalist Georgi Markov in 1978. Just 1.5 millimeters across and mounted here on a pinhead, the pellet had holes through which the poison was inserted. They gave an important clue to its origin. The lethal dose must have been so small, scientists were almost certain it could only have been an extract from the castor oil plant. This exhibition won't be open to the public, but much of it may be incorporated in a new police museum, which is now being planned. Paul Arsman at the Forensic Science Laboratories for Thames News.
Thank you.
No one will give a precise figure on the number of young people sleeping rough in London tonight, except to say the problem's getting worse by the moment, with middle-class southerners now joining the traditional working-class emigres from the north in the hunt for that elusive job.
How long have you been in London?
Just over a week.
Why on earth did you come down here?
It's a sad hole in Liverpool. It's simple. There's no work. Even my dad, has been out of work for 9 years. Only just got a job now. Sitting girls in all sorts, electricals, plumbing, anything. You just can't get anything. So what have I got down there? No future at all.
Jimmy's lucky. He's got a bed in the dormitory here at the Centrepoint Hostel in Soho. But with space limited and the demand vast, it can only be temporary. But the staff here will help with social security and other problems before turfing him out again.
Well, yes, I think we might have some space. If you could bring John Abel down to our gate and we'll interview him to let him in.
But however many such voluntary agencies may shelter at night, there's little that can be done to fill their days and their pockets, with lengthening dole queues and barely enough state cash for even the basic necessities like food. Many young drifters find other alternatives.
What about the business of male prostitution? Is fairly rife around here as well.
Well, you see them around. I've got at least two friends who are. But
because they want to be?
I'm not too sure. They don't talk about it much. Whether they enjoy it or not is up to them. It's their life.
They make money, presumably, don't they?
Yes.
Good money?
I don't know. They've always got money in their pockets.
And the police, particularly the West End Street Offences Squad, are only too aware that the rootless youngster represents not only a potential criminal, but also a potential victim, as the Nilsen trial all too vividly revealed.
When you get young people on their own in the West End without really much experience of life, they can become involved through the many other sordid characters that we have in the area. They could indeed become victims in a similar fashion.
Despite run-ins with the police, the newcomers like Jimmy and Jason remain confident that with a lucky break, a good deal perhaps, all will work out. The long-standing drifters, though, find the facade of confidence more difficult to maintain.
What are your feelings at the moment, though? I mean, are you frustrated, lonely?
No, not really. No, I'm just hoping that it changes, but so far it hasn't.
What do you see yourself doing in, say, a year's time?
I'm in a bed sitting and getting a job.
Do you think that's really likely?
No, not a chance.
And with no hope and no money, the temptations come easy. The prospect of a free drink and meal virtually irresistible, no matter the real motives of the person making the offer. This is Stephen Chambers in the West End.
And we went to Muswell Hill, and he said I could sleep there and have food there the next day until he found us somewhere. I fell asleep, and about 3:30 in the morning, I woke up, and he was right beside me. And I looked at him, I said, what are you doing? And he said, you knocked the fire over, and that's why I woke you up. It could have burnt the carpet. But after that, I didn't get back to sleep, because it was hot in there, but I didn't get back to sleep. And he wouldn't, and he kept on talking. He said, why don't you go to sleep? Go to sleep, for goodness sake. For God's sake, go to sleep. I fell asleep for about another hour. He fell asleep too. And then when we woke up, I went. I left.
Tonight, as usual, the streets of London will provide home and bed for hundreds, and the numbers continue to rise. Apart from the regular down-and-outs, there's a growing army of younger people looking for work or a new life. What they need is a secure home and a job, but often they're denied either. A 25-year-old.
You go down, you go to the casual places. There's no work at all for anybody, because they turn around and say to you, where you living? As soon as you give them no fixed abode, they just don't want to know. You go to the job centre, they turn around and say, well, where do you live? No fixed abode. Tell you, sorry, we can't help you with a job. Come back when you've got a place to live.
They've often deliberately cut all links with the past, and this makes them an easy target for exploitation by criminals or con men. Now there's the increasing threat of violence, and this worries Nick Fenton, who runs the Centrepoint Refuge for Homeless Youngsters.
I think that that's probably one of the prices that some people will have to pay if they can't get themselves sorted out pretty fast when they come down to London. It's an increasingly violent place, and we are most concerned, particularly for young people.
Desperate relatives often turn for help to this office in the East End, where the Salvation Army's Missing Persons Bureau has thousands of names on its files. They reckon to trace 70% of them, but many...
...says that when he was finally arrested, he walked out of one prison into another. But does she still think of Dennis as her son?
Yes, he's always my son. And that's why I want him to know that we're all concerned about him. And I just hope he'll get some help to cope with the situation he's in.
Life took Dennis Nilsen from a childhood in the spacious countryside of northeast Scotland to the dark, dingy streets of London's West End. He found there were so many unfortunate youngsters. As Nilsen wrote later, I decided to release them from the slings and arrows of their outrageous fortune. John Underwood, News at 10, in North London.
The other one I picked up.
Give them a piece of bone, and pathologists say they can tell whether it comes from a man or woman, how old the individual was at the time of death, the height and build of the person, even racial characteristics. But all that depends on having a large enough piece of bone to examine.
This case was that of a person who had been found in a skeletal state some months after death. And two of the most useful bones, from my point of view, were these at the back of the neck, the uppermost part of the neck. And these cuts in the bone indicated that an attempt had been made at decapitation.
With smaller bone fragments, identification is much more difficult. Cell sections can be used to discover whether the bone is human. But the best evidence of all is dental evidence. If they have access to the original dental records, pathologists can make a positive identification on the basis of just one or two teeth. In North London, the police have been finding some dental evidence. It's being taken to the Hornsey mortuary for examination by a Home Office pathologist. And staff at the London Hospital's Medical College will examine skulls, jaws, and even fragments of teeth before the painstaking process of dental identification is concluded. John Underwood, News at 10, at the London Hospital. Mental hospital, special school, eventually Borstal, and then prison.
He was wild, yeah, because when he went to dances, he used to fight with his mates coming home, you know. Always the fists up, always on the defensive, all the time.
Sort of very
Bob
Blythe
is a social worker who knew Steve Sinclair.
I suppose that Steve fell into the group of youngsters that had certain problems that he couldn't cope with, and felt that perhaps by coming to London he could have a new opportunity to resolve those difficulties.
Why then was it a bad idea for him to come to London? I mean, what sort of problems did he face when he came?
Well, I think like most of the youngsters that come to London, the first thing that they find is that London isn't what it appears to be on television, which are the bright lights of Piccadilly. But really, London is a very sad place.
Now inhabit the shadowy world of London's West End. A
world of night shelters and lodging units, a world of drug abuse and emotional problems, triggered by a deep feeling of frustration born out of the knowledge that they are the forgotten generation, a generation upon which Dennis Nilsen preyed.
And basically, obviously,
John Listeners has been studying the man for the past 9 months. He's written a book on the Nilsen affair, which is being serialised in the News of the World.
The Crown said that he was in command of the situation, that he knew what he was doing all the time. The defence said that he did not know what he was doing when he committed the acts of murder.
But what sort of a man do you think Dennis Nilsen is?
I think Nilsen was a man who stalked victims by night in a patch he knew very well, areas that he'd been to as a policeman, as a night guard. He loved the sordid, seamy life. He used to observe it. He's a voyeur of the underworld, if you like. And I think over the years, he grew so much a part of it that he wanted something more. His office life, I think, was very boring. He was a very strong union man, but he wanted an excitement which he never found in the civil service.
Dennis Nilsen spared Carl Stotter, but at least 15 people weren't so lucky. They paid the ultimate price for Dennis Nielsen's hospitality. He killed them, he chopped up their bodies, and he then burned, boiled, or buried the pieces. But Nielsen's reign of carnage was coming to an end. In February of this year, a dino rod man discovered some human remains in a manhole near Nielsen's last home in North London. Nielsen was arrested, and a search of Melrose Avenue and Cranley Gardens revealed more than 1,000 pieces of flesh and bone.
Do you
think
you can take us off?
Not today, no.
Is it Mr. Barr with you, sir?
That way, I...
The cadets arrive mid-morning, 17 years old and fresh from the police training school in North London. They set to work straight away on their hands and knees, scratching at the surface soil on the wasteland behind the house. And it was clear from the beginning they were making a lot of finds. What looked like dozens of pieces of bone and clothing were being collected in plastic bags. The bones were being turned up almost every minute.
We found a small piece of jaw and some teeth attached to it in the rear garden of the premises at Melrose Avenue. And this morning I found a significant amount of property, in particular quite a large consignment of human bones, in particular a large piece of thigh bone in the region of about 6 inches.
Are these bones going to make it more easy for you to identify possible victims?
I don't know, but obviously the more we find, it must assist the pathologist in his subsequent findings.
So it might be made easier?
It may well do, yes.
The search continues tomorrow and should last until the weekend. Carol Barnes, ITN in North London.
After a short spell as a security guard, became a civil servant working for the Manpower Services Commission in several job centres around London. He lived at one, a lonely man who spent many solitary hours gazing at Karl Marx's grave and who bored his workmates with interminable chatter. Dennis Nilsen craved company. He found it in the pubs of North London, the Black Cat by Camden Town Tube Station, the Golden Lion in the heart of Soho, the Salisbury in the West End. It was in these pubs that Nilsen met his victims. Carl Stotter met Nilsen at the Black Cap, where he agreed to go back to Nielsen's flat.
I fell asleep, and I woke up and he was strangling me. And I passed out after sort of thinking, I thought that I'd got caught up in the sleeping bag which he'd warned me about. And I thought he was helping me out, but he wasn't. And anyway, I passed out from that. And I remember vaguely hearing water running and being carried, and I felt very cold, and I realised I was in the bath and he was trying to drown me.
Dennis Andrew Nilsen was born on the 23rd of November 1945 in Fraserburgh, Scotland. He spent the early years of his life in this house. According to his mother, he was a quiet boy. Little, if anything, marked him out from the ordinary.
Nilsen went to school in Fraserburgh, but during his school days he never knew his father and walked out on the family while Dennis was still very young.
We pick up
at
any
the time of his arrest,
whatever,
Dennis Nilsen hadn't seen his mother for 10 years.
How do you think Dennis was able to become involved in this kind of problem and then be able to live from day to day?
Well, that's the bit I don't understand. I just don't understand how this could go on and nobody knowing anything. I mean, I don't know any but these 10 years of his life. And I can't see what was happening to him. Something must have happened to him, because it's not my Dennis that's doing it. Not the boy I knew that's doing these things.
I just can't get over it.
How has it affected the family?
It's affected every one of them.
Would you have any kind of warning to the parents of youngsters, particularly here in Scotland, who were thinking in terms of going down to London?
Never to go. It's such a cruel, horrible place.
The London train pulls out from Edinburgh's Waverley station. Apart from businessmen and holidaymakers, it often carries teenagers, some of them stolen ones, fleeing from death. Death in many of Scotland's sprawling housing estates. These were the victims of Dennis Nilsen, drifted to the straight to London in the expectation of streets paved with gold. People like Billy Sutherland, who was killed by Nilsen after a massive drinking session. Billy Sutherland lived on an estate in Edinburgh, where he was unable to get a job. Even the graffiti here seems to spring from a deep well of bitterness and frustration.
When the first brought up on News at 10, when we saw the ground, and I didn't really think about it much, because I didn't think Billy could be one of the victims. He knew how to handle himself, take care of himself. And it wasn't until I learned that Billy was one of the victims, and it hit me that all these policemen were walking all over his body and all over the other victims' bodies that were buried in the garden. I mean, I loved the guy, I married him.
Dennis Nilsen is charged with murdering Kenneth Ockenden, Martin Duffy, William Sutherland, Malcolm Barlow, John Howlett and Stephen Sinclair on various unknown dates between December 1979 and February of this year. He's also accused of attempting to murder Douglas Stewart and Paul Nobbs. As each of the 8 charges were read out, the defendant was asked, "How say you, Nilsen, are you guilty or not guilty?" 8 times in a firm voice he replied, "Not guilty." But prosecuting counsel told the court that when Mr. Nilsen was arrested earlier this year, he admitted to the police that over a 4-year period he'd killed 15 or 16 people and tried to kill about 7 more. But is Nilsen guilty of murder, as the prosecution says he is, or is he guilty only of manslaughter? That was the question raised by Mr. Alan Green for the prosecution. He told the jury, "There's no dispute that the defendant killed the 6 men he's accused of murdering. There's no dispute he killed them unlawfully. But at the time, was his mental responsibility substantially reduced? If it was, then Nilsen is guilty only of manslaughter." The prosecution is now outlining the circumstances that led to Nilsen's arrest and the details of the Crown's case. The trial continues this afternoon. John Underwood, News at 1, at the Old Bailey.
Police digging in their plastic tent this morning found the bones a few inches below the surface just outside the back door. They think there might be several bodies buried in the garden. All day, detectives and forensic science experts have been moving equipment behind the house, taking the bones and what they describe as other items for examination in a laboratory. The house has been empty for some time. Builders have spent 9 months renovating and converting it into flats.
we found a number of interesting items which can only be established once pathologists have done this.
Are you satisfied that they are in fact human bodies?
This is a possibility, yes. That they are human bodies, yes.
Then more digging, and in the middle of the afternoon, another announcement. More bones, identifiably old ones, and certainly human.
We have found considerable items of bone this morning and this afternoon, and we will continue with the search tomorrow. No, I'm sorry, I'm not scientifically minded, but I would think that probably one piece is from a hip and a small part of a rib.
It appears as though the bodies have been burnt in the back garden before burial.
It's a possibility.
In the next few days, police will dig up the whole garden and sift every ounce of soil. Then they'll start on the house itself, ripping up floorboards and checking every possible hiding place. Phil Roman, ITN, North London.
Dennis Nilsen, who's 37 and comes from Aberdeen, was again in court for only a brief minute, looking as impassive as when he first appeared last weekend, in his pale blue open neck shirt and blue anorak, the same clothes he wore in court then. He's charged with the murder of 20-year-old Stephen Sinclair on or about the 1st of February at number 23 Cranley Gardens in Muswell Hill in North London. Nilsen was escorted from the court immediately after the hearing. He was taken back to Hornsey Police Station, but he'll appear again at Highgate on Friday, when I understand police will ask for him to be moved to Brixton Prison. Carol Barnes, ITN, Highgate Magistrates Court. Nilsen spoke clearly and articulately in his soft Scottish accent of this, his 14th court appearance. He complained that he was given no facilities for confidentiality over his defence papers. He said, "These papers are frequently read by security guards in prison, and on occasion, individual items have been removed from my cell and returned to me later for reasons I don't know." He was told to take the matter up with the prison governor. The prison governor, he replied, refuses to take up any of these matters. With that, he was escorted from the court and back to prison, but not before bidding us a special farewell. Carol Barnes, News at One, Highgate Magistrates Court.
The gruesome search continues under the arc lights and tarpaulin for what the police now believe are dismembered remains that have been buried for 3 years or more. The meticulous checking of the topsoil up to a foot down is painstaking and slow to produce results. The forensic teams still have half the garden to sift through, but are they now nearer identifying any of the bodies?
Quite honestly, no, we're not. As you appreciate, a lot will depend on whether we get any other evidence outside of the house or from anybody else that may assist us to identify any of the deceased persons.
Has any evidence come to light which you think might lead the search going in other directions, in other areas?
Not at the moment. I prefer to keep that option open.
Detectives in charge of the case now think there's a real possibility that some of the bodies may never be positively identified. Searching here will tomorrow extend to an area of waste ground behind the and the news at 10, Cricklewood.
Today, as every day, the calls have continued to come in.
Can I help you at all? You have a problem with a missing son. Oh, dear. And how long has he been missing? 3 months. And you've heard nothing at all from him in the meantime.
And now there's added fear for the families of the missing youngsters and many more calls to the Bureau.
I guess there are some people who are imagining that their relative is somehow or other linked with this unfortunate situation. And this is putting terror into them, as you can imagine. So a lot of people have been ringing up saying, is it possible that this could be my family, my relative?
The man currently being questioned by police is a 37-year-old civil servant, Andrew Nielsen, known to his colleagues at work as Des. For the past 6 months, he's been working here at the Manpower Services Commission in London's Kentish Town. Before that, he'd worked at two other branches of the MSC. Today, his employers are saying that Mr. Nielsen is an efficient worker.
It seems his contact with the public is relatively minimal. His job is to process applications for the government's employment transfer scheme. Mr. Nielsen's been a civil servant for 6 years, and it seems that before that he worked for a security firm. I understand that he's also a former policeman, having been in the force for about a year in the early 70s. John Underwood, News at 10 in North London.
Well, it was about 8 o'clock, and the police came to the front door and said, could they go in my garden? So I said, yes, there's no reason why they shouldn't. Then they said, there's something unpleasant going on next door. So I said, which way? And they pointed that way. So I said, yes, carry on. So they came down through here, down to the garden, and they were up and down with torches. But I don't know what they did.
The search then moved here to another house a few miles away in Cricklewood. From what they'd learned, the police started looking for up to 13 more bodies. It's believed they could be tramps and vagrants from a nearby hostel.
Police had kept watch on the house all night and erected a huge tarpaulin over the area they planned to dig. It's mostly bare earth with a small concrete patio, and though heat-sensing equipment may be used later, today it was a straight matter of shovels and spades which arrived mid-morning. Later, more officers arrived with some plastic sheeting and boots. And then dogs were brought in to help in the search. The house has been empty for 2 years and was squatted in by winos and vagrants, but recently builders had been working in the house and garden.
We were digging in the garden, just removing builders' rubbish and rubble
in the morning,
just, and they came at lunchtime just after we'd been in the garden.
And what was in the garden at that stage?
Just basically our mess after eight months or so, clearing it out.
And you'd been digging there previously, hadn't you?
We hadn't been actually digging in the garden as such. We'd just been moving the stuff we'd added to the garden, so we left underneath that as it was.
We had dug four holes about that deep
right at the end
of the garden for some fence posts.
And you didn't discover anything at all?
We didn't discover anything.
No. There could in fact be anything buried there.
There could be anything buried there, yeah.
Judge, Mr. Justice Croom Johnson, told the jury they had to decide whether Nielsen's responsibility for the killings was impaired, and if so, whether the impairment was substantial. He told them, there is no specific test for you to apply, it is simply for you to use your common sense. Summing up the case for the prosecution, Mr. Alan Green said Nielsen knew that what he was doing was wicked and against the law, but he kept on doing it. Countering the argument that Nielsen suffered diminished responsibility, Mr. Green said, Nielsen's sense of right and wrong were not impaired. He knew perfectly well that what he was doing was the gravest of crimes. Summing up the defence case, Mr. Ivan Lawrence, QC, told the jury they were sitting in a court which had heard some horrific cases. But I doubt whether it has heard such a catalogue of dreadful killings, he says. Does not common sense cry out, he must be out of his mind? Mr. Lawrence repeated details of the evidence, the way Nielsen disposed of the bodies, living with them under the floorboards for months at a time, putting human entrails in the garden for the neighbours' cats and dogs, boiling severed heads in a saucepan. He said, what stronger indication could you have of just how substantially the mind of this man is impaired? Anne Lucas, ITN at the Old Bailey. In summing up the case for the prosecution, Mr. Alan Green said that Nielsen relished enormously the power he was exercising over life and death. He knew perfectly well that what he was doing was wicked and against the law. He went on doing it, and did it with considerable deliberation, not impetuously, said Mr. Green. To counter the defence argument that Nielsen suffered from diminished responsibility at the time of the killings, the prosecution said, Nielsen's sense of right and wrong were not impaired. He knew perfectly well that what he was doing was among the gravest of crimes. In summing up the defence case, Mr. Ivan Lawrence, QC, told the jury they were sitting in the most famous court in the land. This court has heard some horrific cases, he said, but I doubt whether it has heard such a catalogue of dreadful killings. Does not common sense cry out, he must be out of his mind? Mr. Lawrence repeated details of some of the evidence, the way Nielsen disposed of the bodies, living with them under the floorboards for months at a time, putting people's entrails in the garden for the neighbours' cats and dogs, boiling severed heads in a cooking pot. What stronger indication could you have of just how substantially the mind of this man is impaired, he said. The trial continues. Anne Lucas, News at 1 at the Old Bailey. Heard that the 16 killings followed a pattern. Every victim was a young man, usually without a permanent address, and Nilsen met most of them in pubs. They'd go back to Nilsen's flat and would often get involved in a heavy drinking session. For the prosecution, Mr. Alan Green described what had happened to 16 victims, reading from a statement Nilsen made to police, allegedly admitting the murders. He said one was strangled with an electric flex, another with a strap from a chair, and one Nilsen strangled with his bare hands. Others were killed with a necktie. Throughout the hearing, Nilsen sat in the dock referring to a sheaf of typewritten papers. Occasionally, he'd jot down a note and pass it to his solicitor. 12 of the 16 murders happened at Nilsen's flat in Melrose Avenue, North London. Each time, he hid the body under the floorboards or in a shed which he sprayed every day with disinfectant or aerosol deodorant. The prosecution say Nilsen was asked by police how many bodies were under the floorboards at any one time. He replied, I didn't do a stock check or anything, it's all a bit of a jumble. Before leaving the flat, Nilsen had three bonfires in the garden to destroy the remains. In February this year, a plumber was called to unblock the drains at Nielsen's new flat at Cranley Gardens. He lifted the manhole cover and found 30 or 40 pieces of human flesh, which had been flushed down the lavatory. Police questioned Nilsen, asking where the rest of the body was. In two plastic bags in the wardrobe, Nilsen replied. Police said, are we talking about one body or two? Nilsen said, 16. I'll tell you everything. The trial continues tomorrow. Anne Lucas, News at 10 at the Old Bailey.
Nilsen was very relieved that, number one, the trial was over. I think in his own mind he expected a longer sentence, and he discussed with me the difference in the sentences between him and other clients that I have represented in the past.
Other clients such as who?
Such as, for example, David Martin and the Cray twins.
The house is in a prestigious area of North London, though it doesn't match the immaculate suburban charm of its neighbours. Dennis Nilsen paid £100 a month rent for a two-room flat on the top floor. Three of his victims were killed here, and police arrested Nilsen after the drains became blocked with pieces of human flesh. As the horrific details emerged, the owner of the house decided to sell. Police gutted the flat looking for evidence, but some of Nilsen's possessions are still there. The collar worn by his pet dog Bleep, described during the trial as his only real friend. Relics from his brief career as a police officer. His inscription refers to a page explaining the theft act. The agents are resigned to the gruesome history of the house becoming a selling feature.
We don't really have much option. I mean, if we're going to sell it, it will become common knowledge and it will become generally known, and we don't really have any alternative.
So far, they've had one definite offer, and two film companies are believed to be interested. Anne Lucas, News at 10, North London. Chief Inspector Peter Jay read out the statement, which he said was in Nielsen's own handwriting. It was an attempt at self-analysis and his own description of his behaviour in what he called a condition induced by rapid and heavy ingestion of alcohol.
Stayed for a while in a hotel in London's King's Cross area until one damp and overcast Monday morning, shortly before he was due to return to Canada, he simply went missing.
On the 3rd of December 1979, Kenneth Ockenden left his hotel at between 9 and 10 in the morning. It was the last time he was positively seen alive. In his hotel room, the police found his personal diary, from which they were able to reconstruct every journey he'd made during his 3-month stay in the UK. What they didn't find was Kenneth Uppenden's British passport or his Canadian driving licence.
In December of last year, the police said there was a strong possibility that Kenneth Uppenden had been murdered. But he did make one last phone call. It was to his uncle in Surrey. The call came from a public call box. There was music in the background. On the anniversary of Kenneth Uppenden's disappearance, the police said the call probably came from a London pub. There has, up until now, been no trace of the missing man. John Underwood, News at 10, in King's Cross.
The other alleged victim was Carl Stotter. He almost broke down while giving evidence and was offered a glass of water. Mr. Stotter told the court he was a homosexual. He and Nilsen were in bed together when, he said, he felt Nilsen's hands round his neck. He remembered being held over the bath. He said, "He was pushing me under the water. I just thought I was dying." He told the court he recovered consciousness in bed, and Nilsen told him he must have had a nightmare. The trial continues tomorrow.